Want to learn how to do a bank reconciliation?
In this video, I'll show you how to reconcile the bank statement to the cash book in 7 simple steps. Hey viewers, I'm James and welcome to Accounting Stuff, the channel that teaches you all there is to know about accounting basics and bookkeeping software. In this video, you'll learn how to prepare a full bank reconciliation like this one by yourself from scratch.
Looks a bit scary, doesn't it?
But don't worry, I'm going to break down this whole process for you into 7 easy steps that will make this whole bank rec business seem like a piece of cake. I've had to review my fair share of bank reconciliations during my previous life as an auditor, and today I'd like to share with you the approach that I find easiest to follow. And before I forget, this video is a continuation of our series on accounting basics. So if you'd like to see more videos just like this, then check out the playlist up here. And don't forget to subscribe. Let's do this. First off, there are a couple of definitions that we need to clarify. A bank statement. A bank statement is a list of all of the cash receipts and withdrawals that a business thinks it has made over a period of time. And it's managed, as you would expect, by the bank. A cash book is an accounting record of what a business thinks it has in the bank, along with all of the cash inflows, debits, and outflows, credits. It's managed by the business itself, usually by an accountant or bookkeeper. So on the one hand, the bank produces a bank statement, and on the other, the business maintains a cash book. In an ideal world, the closing balances of both of these should equal each other exactly. However, in reality, that's not the case, and it's actually the reason why the bank reconciliation exists, to make sure that these two reports agree on what's been going on in the bank. I'll show you how that works in a moment, but first, let me explain why the bank statement and cash book might disagree with each other in the first place. There are 3 ways that these differences can come about. Reason number 1, omissions. Omissions relate to transactions that appear on the bank statement, but haven't yet been recorded by the business in its cash book. These include things like missing receipts, interest received, bank fees, and bounced checks. A business might not know that these transactions have hit their bank account until they receive their bank statement at the end of the month. Reason number 2, timing differences. These are transactions that are recorded in the bank statement and the cash book in different periods. The 2 most common timing differences are deposits in transit and outstanding checks. A deposit in transit, or as some people like to call it, an unrecorded deposit, relates to cash that a business receives and records in its cash book during one period, but that doesn't appear in its bank statement until the following period. Typically, these are checks or electronic fund transfers that the business receives from its customers towards the end of the month that the bank doesn't process immediately. An outstanding check is a check that a business sends to a supplier in one month that might just sit on their desk for a while and not actually get cashed in until the following month. So again, we have that timing difference between when the transaction is recorded in the bank statement and the cash book. The 3rd way that we get differences between the bank statement and the cash book is because of errors. Someone's messed up. Now, errors can be made by the bank or the accountant preparing the cash book, but more often than not, it's these guys. So we first look for errors in the cash book, not the bank statement. Although, that is also possible. Make sense? Good. So we've identified omissions, timing differences, and errors, which can all cause differences between the bank statement and the cash book. The purpose of the bank reconciliation is to identify every single one of these errors so we know what the heck is going on. It then tees us up nicely to post a journal into the general ledger and bring that cash book up to date by accounting for omissions and correcting for errors. Those timing differences in the bank statement? Well, there's not much we accountants can do about those except identify them and let them sort themselves out in future periods. That's all well and good, but why is all this useful? Why is it necessary? Well, I touched on it a moment ago, but the bank reconciliation is essential if you want to ensure that your books are up to date and give an accurate picture of the business. It also allows you to calculate the true cash balance of the business. That's how much money you've got after all of the outstanding checks and deposits have cleared the bank. So when do these bank reconciliations actually happen? Most businesses prepare their bank recs on a monthly basis after they receive their bank statements at the end of the month. Large companies with many transactions might reconcile on a weekly or even a daily basis, whereas smaller companies with fewer transactions might only reconcile their cash account once every 6 months. Right, I know what you're probably thinking at this point. James, you promised me 7 steps at the start of this video. Where's my 7 steps? Hold tight, they're coming. We've dealt with what, why, and when, And now I'm going to show you how to prepare a bank reconciliation.
About time!
To help you visualize these steps, we're going to walk through them with an example company, Chudley Cannons Incorporated. And if you're a Harry Potter nerd like I am, then you're probably aware that's Ron's favorite Quidditch team. Trivia. Or if you've been following accounting stuff for a while now, you might also remember the Cannons from my videos on the cash flow statement, which are up here. For this example, we're going to reconcile the Chudley Cannons cash account for the month ended the 30th of June. And now, the moment we've all been waiting for, bring on those steps. Step one, get copies of the bank statement and cash book for the period that you want to reconcile. So let's grab those then. On the left side of the screen, we've got a copy of the Chudley Cannons bank statement from Gringotts. This lists out all of the amounts deducted and added to the Chudley Cannons cash account in June, along with descriptions and the opening and closing balances. And beneath me, we have the transaction listing for the unadjusted cash account. This comes straight from the general ledger and details all of the transactions affecting the cash book, along with dates, descriptions, debits and credits, opening and closing balances. You'll notice that both of these reports are for the period ended the 30th of June. They both have a very similar layout and we don't want to confuse things, so let's jot down bank statement and cash book to make things clearer. Perfect, time for step two, set up the bank reconciliation template. So open a spreadsheet or grab some paper. Let's give this bank reconciliation a header. Beneath that, we want to divide the page into two, with the bank statement on the left and the cash book on the right. The reconciliation begins with the unadjusted closing balances from each report. These are our starting points, and the aim is to calculate the adjusted closing balances for each side to reconcile these numbers. To help us with that, it's useful to note down the unreconciled amount at the bottom of the page. The aim of the game here is to get this to zero. So what's going on in the middle here? We've got a lot of blank space. This is where all of our adjustments go. Remember the omissions, timing differences, and errors that we talked about earlier? We adjust the bank statement for timing differences and errors that are caused by the bank.
And we adjust the cash book for omissions and errors made by the accountant or bookkeeper. Timing differences are made up of deposits in transit, which we need to add to the closing bank statement balance, and outstanding checks that we need to deduct. Bank errors, they can go either way. It depends on the situation. On the cashbook side, some common omissions are the missing receipts and interest that we need to add, along with bank fees and bounced checks that we need to deduct. The errors in the cashbook also depend on the circumstances.
There we go, the full bank reconciliation template. We'll enter the numbers in a moment, but before that, we've got step three. Tick all of the matching transactions in the bank statement and cash book. These all agree with each other already, so we're going to tick them off so we don't include them in the bank reconciliation. A quick glance over the statement shows us that we can see a deposit of $3,592 in the bank statement and cash book. Check 104 for $235. Also appears in both reports, as does the EFT payment for $545. And last but not least, we have the EFT receipt for $15,982. Check number 106 also appears in both statements, but the amounts are different. We'll revisit that one. Moving swiftly on to step number four. Here we need to calculate the adjusted bank statement balance. Let's go. Our template is telling us that we need to add deposits in transit. Deposits in transit relate to receipts that a business receives in one period and that the bank deposits in another. So we're looking for a debit that increases our cash in the cash book and that doesn't appear in the bank statement. On the 30th of June, we can see a transaction for $2,220 that seems to fit the bill, because there's no sign of it over here. So we need to give that one a reference. Let's say A and add it to the bank statement side of our bank rec. It goes here because that transaction already exists in our cash book, making up part of that unadjusted balance. Next, we want to find any outstanding checks. These are the checks that the Cannons have sent out to a customer this month, but haven't been cashed in yet. These will appear as a credit or reduction to cash in the cash book because the payment has been recognized in the general ledger. But there'll be no sign of them in the bank statement because they haven't been cashed in yet. Check 105 jumps out at me. The Cannons have recorded a payment of $910 on the 12th of June, and it doesn't appear in the bank statement. Let's identify this as transaction B and deduct it from the bank statement side of our bank reconciliation. Remember that this transaction already appears in the cash book, and we expect this customer to cash the check the following month, which is when it will appear in the bank statement. So for now, we adjust the bank statement. The final adjustment to include on the bank statement side of the bank rec would be any bank errors that exist. We don't appear to have any here, and more often than not, that's the case. If you happen to come across any in your bank reconciliations, then it's best to identify the adjustment and contact the bank so that they can fix the error ASAP. Look, I don't know, it's your problem, sort it out. Now that we've worked out the adjusted closing bank balance, we should be feeling pretty confident that we've worked out the true cash balance of the business. $53,498. That's the cash balance after all outstanding checks and deposits have cleared the bank. But we won't know for sure until we've finished step 5, which is where we calculate the adjusted cash book balance. That means we're on the lookout for omissions or stuff that's in here that we haven't recorded in here. We've already written down some of the common omissions in our bank reconciliation template. So let's work through these. Missing receipts are amounts that have been added to our bank account that we haven't recorded in our cash book. In this bank statement, we can see that the Cannons have received an electronic fund transfer for $1,000 on the 29th of June. And I can't see it anywhere in the cash book, so we must have missed this one out. Let's reference that as transaction C and add it to the cash book balance in our bank reconciliation. Right, what's next? Interest received. We're looking for amounts added to our bank account that have interest in the description. On the 30th of June, we can see interest received of $107. Has it been recorded in our cash book already? Nah. So we reference it as transaction D and add it to our cash book balance in our bank rec. Bank fees. These are costs that the bank charges us for keeping our account open. I can see that $50 was deducted from our account on the 17th of June, and we haven't included it in our cash book. We're going to label this one as transaction E, and this time we're going to deduct it from our cash book balance in our bank rec, because we need to recognize a payment. The last omission that we're looking for is bounced checks. These are checks that customers have mailed to us and that we've deposited in the bank, only to find that these have been rejected because the customer didn't have sufficient funds to honor the check. This kind of check is normally labeled as an NSF check. NSF stands for not sufficient funds. We can see one in our bank statement here. NSF check 2748, and the bank has deducted $6,000 from our account. We need to reference this as transaction F and deduct it from our cash book balance in our bank reconciliation. I smell the finish line. The unreconciled amount is now just $45, and all that's left to do is find the errors in the cash book. This is going to be easy to spot because we followed all of the steps and we've ticked and referenced all of the other transactions already. And as if that wasn't enough, we've got a note beneath the cash account transaction listing that explains what the error is. Check number 106 is for $7,050 and it's been incorrectly entered into the general ledger. It looks as though the bookkeeper or accountant that entered this check made a typo or something because it's been correctly recorded in our bank statement. No worries, we'll reference that as transaction G and deduct the difference of $45 from the cash book balance in our bank rec. Ta-da! Our unreconciled amount is now zero. And that also means that we've completed step 6. Check that the adjusted totals match each other. In order to complete the bank reconciliation, it's critical that the adjusted bank balance matches the adjusted cash book balance exactly. That proves that we've recorded all of the cash transactions in the general ledger. And what we've worked out here is our true cash balance of $53,498. If you're still getting a difference in your bank reconciliation, then unfortunately there's an error somewhere in your workings and you'll need to go back over all those steps and make sure you've done them correctly. But not today, my friend, not today. We've crushed this bank rec so we can move on to the last part of the process, step 7. Prepare the necessary journal entries. This is very important because if we don't post these journals to correct the cash balance in the current month, then all of these cash book adjustments will just appear again next time we do the bank rec. So let's do our future selves a solid and prepare the journals. We'll be thanking ourselves later. Just to be clear, the adjustments that we've identified in the bank statement side are all timing differences. We can leave these be and they'll correct themselves in the future when the bank records our deposit and when that customer cashes that check. We're only posting journal entries for the adjustments that affect our cash book, so let's do it. And if you're feeling kind of unsure about journal entries, then that's okay. Pause this video and check out this one up here that I made explaining them. We need to lay out our journal entry template with the date, account, debit, and credit columns. For the date, we're going to pick the 30th of June for all of these entries because it's the last day of the month and it makes month-end correcting journals like this one easy for us to spot when reviewing the general ledger. Going into this, we also know that one side of each transaction has to hit the cash account because these are all cash book adjustments. Let's take it from the top.
Transaction C was for missing receipts of $1,000. We're adding this to our cash account, so we need to debit cash by $1,000. And the other side of the journal is a credit to decrease accounts receivable because one of our customers has paid us. Next, we have transaction D, interest received of $107. Again, this is a debit to cash because the Canons have earned that interest, and the other side is a credit to interest income, which is a form of revenue. In transaction E, we were charged bank fees, so we need to credit cash by $50 to decrease them and debit bank fees to recognize the expense. Then we have transaction F, which was for a $6,000 bounced check. We credit cash for this too to reduce our cash balance, and we debit accounts receivable to increase it because the customer still owes us that $6,000. And on to the final journal. This one is for transaction G, which is an error that we need to correct. We had mistakenly recorded a check payment in our cash book at $7,005, which was actually meant for $7,050. So we need to credit cash to recognize the higher payment value and debit accounts payable to bring those down.
Oh yeah, that's the full steps 1 to 7 complete. All that's left to do is post this journal, and the general ledger will be updated for the June period to reflect the true cash balance of our business. Our work here is done. That's how to prepare a bank reconciliation from start to finish. I hope you found those 7 steps useful and start putting them into practice in your real life bank recs. Thanks for watching this video. If you found it useful, give it a like, share it, comment, subscribe if you haven't already. There are new videos every week here on Accounting Stuff. Best of luck with those bank reconciliations. If you keep to these 7 steps, you'll smash them every time, no problem. See you next time.